So I actually presented a or gave go to a kind of a series of different topics that you might do. They picked this one for a couple of reasons. One, it's interesting, I hope anyways, of a topic. It's very applicable. And how many people here are on elixirforums.com? One. So the rest of you should go there and make it. It's actually really good. Jose Valim, the guys behind Phoenix Framework, they're all there. They hang out. They answer questions. It's still a really nice, small community. It's a fantastic place. One thing I noticed, and I've answered a lot of questions on there about this exact topic or a set of topics, is like, how do you deal with this process, this concept in Elixir? And it seems to be something that's not completely obvious, which is fair enough because it's a unique feature to Elixir and Erlang and anything on the Beam. So I thought we would talk about this because it's really the key to scaling and really getting the most out of Elixir in general. The little image that we have on the side there is not just for beauty's sake. We'll actually be looking at that live. I've got some live demos and some live visualizations that we'll do later. We'll actually see this in action. So this is one of my favorite quotes from the world of physics by a mathematician and physicist from the early 20th century, Lewis Fry Richardson. And he was talking about complexity. So he studied things like fluid dynamics. And so a lot of his work, his mathematical work, went into complexity theory. And this is the way he described it. Big worlds have little worlds that feed on their velocity, and little worlds have lesser worlds, and so on to viscosity. And it's the same thing with Elixir. The idea is that big Elixir programs are made of smaller Elixir programs, and those smaller Elixir programs are often made of smaller Elixir programs until we get to the base unit of processes. And really, to take full advantage of Elixir, your programs need to be designed and written with concurrency in mind. We're going to talk about what concurrency is as well, because that's sometimes a question. What is concurrency exactly? By the way, if you have questions, comments, if I'm speaking too fast, just put up your hand and we can have a conversation. Yeah? So when it comes to concurrency, to scaling, to durability in Elixir, processes are the key mechanic. So processes are shared nothing execution contexts, which are preemptively scheduled across a set of OS threads. That's a big sentence, lots of words. We're going to break that down and look at what they actually are in like human terms. The most important thing to remember about processes, however, is that they are inherently designed to be run concurrently. So we're going to break our programs up into little pieces, run them as separate processes, and these can be run completely concurrently. So what we're going to look at in the presentation today is how to write small programs, combine them into larger programs, distribute them across compute resources, and run all those little small programs concurrently. If that sounds a lot like microservices in the general, it is. And Erlang was like way ahead of that concept. These concepts in Erlang were developed in the late 80s, which is, to me, astounding. The microservices were definitely not a thing back then. So who here has played with Phoenix Framework on Elixir to do like web stuff? Cool. So Joe Armstrong, who's one of the three guys that invented Erlang back in the day. Has everyone seen the Erlang movie on YouTube? No, you should. It's fantastic. It's wonderfully, embarrassingly geeky and wonderful. Joe was in that. So he observed, a year ago or so. And he was thinking about Phoenix Framework and Elixir and these things. And he said that a lot of people have this weird concept that when you write like a web app with Elixir or with Erlang, you have like an app. And you have a web server that can handle, like 2 million concurrent connections, and that's amazing. But he said, no, it's the wrong way of looking at it. We don't have one web server handling 2 million sessions. We have 2 million web servers, each handling one session. And this is like the core concept of processes and concurrency in Elixir. In fact, when you start the Erlang or Elixir, or the IEX, this is actually a map and we're not going to go through it now, but this is a map of actually all the processes that are started. You just look like you start up a REPL like anything else, right? Like in Ruby or whatever. But this is actually what's happening behind the scenes, and all of these processes are just spawned and created for you, and they actually support the system that you're actually using. You don't see that, and that's the magic. Okay, before we get into the details of what is a process, how are they made, I just want to talk about concurrency and parallelism quickly. So concurrency and parallelism are similar, they're not identical. If you drew a Venn diagram, they kind of overlap, but there's some things that are parallel that are not concurrent. There's some things that are concurrent and not parallel. So I thought I'd like have a little exercise that you can all participate in. Well, some of you anyways. And we could actually see the difference between concurrency and parallelism. So how about you four? Let's see. Here's one for you. Here's one for you. One for you, one for you. Cool. And let's do four guys over here. Yes, they're all the same. This is your map. So this is a graph. There we go. So it's a simple directed graph. It's a horrible graph. It's full of cycles and other horrible things. Here, I'll pass a couple other on so you can just see. All right, and then we're going to put four of these here. You guys have to gather around. You guys will be parallel, okay? You guys are going to be concurrent. So you get one, you get one. You get one. Everyone gets one. No, I'm not Oprah. I need each of you to get a pen. Do you have a pen? Do you have a pen? I brought pens. It's called thinking ahead. All right. I'm prepared. I'm short one pen, but it looks like you have a pen.
I thought I had a pen.
Okay, you can use my other pen.
But you have to be good to it.
It's my next pen. All right, so you're blue, you're green, you're yellow, you're red. All right, so what these four guys are going to do is they're going to recreate this graph on these pages. So these guys have the nodes, but there's no graph on it, right? So in this, we're your computer program, and you're going to work together to actually create the edges in the graph. All right? You can only, however, draw the edges that are coming from your color. So take a look at your graph, learn which ones are yours. You're all going to work on the same one. Once you're done, you can then go to the second one. Then you all work on the second one together, and then the third one, etc. Yeah? So you're all working on it together at the same time? You guys just draw the graph. Right? So that's the idea. So you can all start, figure it out. So concurrency, while they're doing this, figuring it out, concurrency is about doing multiple things at the same time, perhaps. Parallelism is about working on the same problem at the same time. There's actually one kind of parallelism that is not concurrent, that I know of anyways, and that's bit-wise parallelism. So if you have like a 16-bit computer or a 32-bit computer, you can do things like bit masks, right, XORs and whatnot. They're actually bit parallel, but they're not concurrent. There's only one thing happening. So you can have parallel behavior that is not concurrent. You guys should start making your graphs. You're racing them. Did I mention that? You guys are in a race. Exactly. The parallel guys are winning right now. They're doing a good job. So just recreate the graph like this one. So, yep. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. So you got it. Yep, you got the graph. Just copy. Concurrency is just about being able to do multiple things at once. It may not actually happen in parallel, but conceptually it could be, right? So in Erlang, every process is run concurrently, but you could be running them in one thread on one CPU. And there's actually only one thing ever happening at a time. One of your processes is running, but conceptually they're concurrent. So we can see here that they're having to work on the same thing. Their hands are like overlapping. It's kind of inconvenient. That's very true about parallelism, right? You have to think about it a lot more. How do you share resources? How do you deal with locking? How do you not get in the way of each other? You also have things like thread starvation. Look at this dude. He's sitting here because he's done. He's like, I got nothing else to do. And the other threads are working their asses off trying to finish it. There we go. That's good. That's good. And that's typical, right? In parallelism, it's really hard to write well-written, reliable, dependent parallel code. However, when it comes to concurrency, you don't really, you just write one thing. You know, you just make the graph. You don't care, but you can do the same graph over and over and over again. They're already done. All right, you guys are done too. Good. But it's much simpler because these guys didn't have to worry about sharing their paper with somebody else. They didn't have to worry about who's red, who's yellow, blah, blah, blah. This is the fundamental difference between parallelism.
Sorry, could you
please repeat everything? Sure, you're so busy. So the difference between parallel and concurrency, right, is that parallel is working on the same problem together. So you split the one problem up and you work on it together simultaneously. Concurrency is just doing a bunch of different things, perhaps the same thing, but at the same time. Perhaps. So with parallelism, inherently there are things happening at the same time. With concurrency, you're just trying to make things that are separately runnable. So in Erlang, as I was saying, or in Elixir, you can have just one scheduler thread that's running all your processes in one thread on one CPU core. There's actually nothing happening in parallel. Everything's happening sequentially. But conceptually, it's still asynchronous concurrent processing. But it's so much easier to design because you don't have to worry about, is this hand in the way or that hand in the way, and who goes next and who's red. You just write your program very simply, like you would write any other sequential program, and the concurrency or the parallelism is taken care of for you. But a lot of people ask about this. They look at it and go, oh God, concurrent programming is going to be so hard. But it's not, because it's not parallel programming. It's concurrent. All right, so that bit of theory out of the way. What is a process in Elixir? It's three things. It's a message box. So processes can send messages to each other. That's how you connect them. So it has an inbox. It gets messages. Okay, that's number one. It has a working set of memory. And this is its own memory. It is not shared with anything else. It's its own memory. And thirdly, it has its own code path. So it has its own execution. Right, so it has its own set of code that it's executing completely separate from everything else. So processes are shared nothing. They get their own message box, their own RAM, and their own execution path. So we'll look at each of these three pieces one at a time in concept, and then we'll look at them practically, and then we'll demo each of these ideas separately and together. So the message box. Any process can receive an arbitrary message. You can just send messages from one process to another. They could be strings, they could be numbers, they could be tuples, they could be maps, structs, doesn't matter. You can just send data from one process to another, and each time you send data, it ends up in the receiving process's inbox. The process can then pick up those messages in the order it wants using pattern matching. I'm not going to go too much in the details of like the basic syntax of Elixir, so if there's anything that I mentioned, like pattern matching or whatnot, that you're not familiar with, just raise your hand, I'll explain a bit more. But this allows basically, so imagine that you go to your mailbox and you get all your letters, right? You look at it and go, there's a bill, there's some, an advertisement, there's the letter from grandma that I was expecting. So we do this normally with our own mail, we filter it through. Your processes can do the same thing. And this message passing is how we tie these smaller programs, the processes, together into bigger programs. So they run and they have some input, they produce some output, and along the way, they're going to be communicating with other processes via messaging. So the memory that each one has, each process gets its own block of RAM. This is important for a number of reasons. Number one, you can just write your process, your code, as if it is truly a small little program running on its own. You don't have anything else that can mess with your memory. You don't have to worry about locking or whatever. It's all yours. The other cool thing is that garbage collection, so it's if you write Elixir code, you notice you're not allocating memory or freeing it. Garbage collection does its thing. But the nice thing about having its own block of memory and from a performance perspective, is that when a process is done, its entire block of memory is just reaped all at once. And so garbage collection becomes O1 in complexity. It just frees the entire block, actually puts the entire block back into rotation. This is really nice because most of the time we deal with languages that are like fast or garbage collected, right? Or complexly garbage collected and pretty fast. So this also tells us something about how we want to design our programs in Elixir, right? We want to write either processes that run for a long period of time, say somebody listens to a socket, so on a web server, listening to socket 443, for instance. That's maybe going to run for the entire lifespan of the server, of the application. And that's okay, but we don't want to allocate a whole bunch of memory in it, right? We want to start with our options, set up the socket, start listening on it, but we probably don't want to be sitting there allocating lots of memory. The other pattern you'll see a lot is short-lived processes that do one thing. So again, in Phoenix, every time a web browser contacts your web app, it spawns a new process, it handles that one request, and the process goes away, and the memory is reaped. This allows you to keep your memory allocation low, so you can be servicing ungodly numbers of connections without using tons of memory, because that memory is being constantly recycled, but it's also doing that very performantly. But it's important to understand how that works, that when you're thinking about how to divide your processes up, you'll do so where you won't run into memory issues. As an interesting side note, you can set per-process memory limits as well. So you can say, only allow this all my processes to grow up to a certain amount, or allow this one process to grow up to a certain amount of memory, and then if it goes beyond that, just kill it. But generally, you don't need to touch any of that stuff. The most important thing about this is that it enforces separation, and it simplifies management, because you're forced just to concentrate on your one process with your one set of allocations, your memory, whatever your data is. If you want to work with some other process, you have to send it via a message. Yeah? So the final pillar, the third piece, is the execution stack. In Elixir, modules are the unit of code organization. So you'll create a module called user auth, or you'll create a module that might have to do with processing a credit card transaction or whatnot. They tend to be topical. So you group all of the functionality for a given thing within one module. In object-oriented programming that a lot of us are very familiar with, or more familiar with, we think of that as the class, right? And that's like both our unit of organization of code, but also our unit of code execution. In Elixir, no. Modules are how we organize code into topics, but processes are how we organize the execution of that code. So in Ruby, you can do mix-ins, right? You can have a class, it mixes in another class, you can extend functionality. In JavaScript, you can take a prototype and extend it at will, add more things to it. This is interesting. In Elixir, you start a process, you give it a beginning point, an initial function, and that initial function then call whatever else it wants. It can call into module A or B or C. It doesn't matter. So the modules, it's nice, it separates out how we organize our code and how we actually organize the execution of it. And this actually ends up making a lot of things unexpectedly cleaner. This also controls when, the execution, of course, it controls when your process is done, right? So as long as there's code to execute, your process continues running. As soon as it says, I'm done, we'll see how you can make sure it's never done, then the process is done, it halts, it exits, it's reaped, it's cleaned from the system, its memory is released and for reuse, etc. So the process, by its code execution, defines the mechanism and the lifespan of the process. This is the job, if you will. So we're going to take a look at these three pieces again, but from a different perspective. Not so much what are they, but what do they give us? How do they work together? How can we use each of them? So the message passing is basically your API. This is how you expose one process to another process. In object-oriented programming, we think of public interfaces in a class, right? In Elixir, we think of the messages that a process is willing to accept, and that's the public API, if you will, of that process. With the separation, the shared nothingness of it, it gives us a really simple way to address separation of concerns and modularity. And we'll look at each of these again in a bit of detail on how this we achieve this. And finally, with each process having its own code execution that can start and end when it needs to, this allows us to do things like lifespan tracking between processes. And this actually is the core of reliability in Erlang for Elixir applications. Sorry, I'm an Erlang developer that picked up Elixir a year and a half ago, so I still think of Erlang. So message passing. sending a message from one process to another, which you can kind of think in object-oriented terms is like one object calling the public API on another object. This is literally the syntax for it. It's just that simple. You say send, and then who do you want to send it to? The receiver, and then the message, right? Like, how valuable can that be? Indy is wondering, is this worthwhile? And I want to make the case that message passing is like the most amazing thing once you actually understand what you can do with it. It's ridiculously simple, but horrendously powerful. So we'll look at each of these pieces in turn. When you do a send, it posts the message to the receiver's inbox, so that message box we talked about. That message is going to be put into their inbox. This is actually going to result in most cases in a copy, like a deep copy of data. And this allows you not to worry about when one process goes away, does it have memory? Conceptually, there are a lot of footnotes that are like, except in this case or that case where there's shared memory and you can reuse and blah, blah, blah. But generally just think of it as it's a deep copy that always happens. Don't worry about performance. They've done a huge amount of work on performance to make sure this works very well. But conceptually, it's a deep copy. You're making a copy and sending it to the receiver's inbox. And then it returns immediately back to you. It's completely asynchronous. You just fire off a message, and you're done. It also happens to return the value. The return value is the message you sent. So you actually chain these, right? So if you have a pipe operator and you're sending through, you can actually chain send. So everything in Elixir is about composability, where you can take a command and then compose it with other calls and create long strings or pipes. So that's useful. The receiver, and this is where we start to see the power of it, it can be a PID. So every process, just like in an operating system, gets assigned a unique number. Actually gets assigned a unique dotted number, which we'll see later. And that's just called the PID, the process identifier. So the receiver can be a PID. So if you know the process ID, maybe you spawned the process, you created the process, so you have the ID. But it doesn't have to be. It can also be an atom that maps to a named process. So you can register processes with a name that's local or global or put into a specific registry, and then you can just send it to that named process. It can also be a tuple of the form atom node to reach a named process on a specific node. Now, a node is a different VM. So you have one VM running your application here, another VM running your application there. It could be on separate machines. In one of the demos, I'll actually look at a system running three nodes on my laptop here. But these are basically separate. You can view them as different, they're different VMs. They don't have to be on the same hardware. So you get in the send function, you get the ability to send messages transparently across the network. PIDs can also be addressed to a different node. So you can actually create a process on a different VM that could be on the other side of the world for all you care, and you can address it. You use that exact same send receiver message. To your process and your applications, it doesn't matter. Now think about that when you're writing, you know, traditional or more traditional microservice architectures, right? And all the hoops you have to run through, and it's like, oh, now we're gonna make some JSON, we're gonna send it across, the other thing listens on port 80. No, screw that. You just do send receiver message. And that's it. And you get all that for free. Best of all, serialization for free. It can also be a port. Now, this is really cool. Just out of curiosity, what other languages do you use mostly for like server-side stuff? Ruby. Ruby. All the cool kids use Ruby. If you don't use Ruby, you don't say anything. Yeah. There's actually a port for Ruby. So a port in the Elixir world is basically a connector to an external process. It can be running anything. And there are ports for different language runtimes. There's one for Ruby. So if you have a Ruby program, or a Python program, or a Rust program, or whatever, you can actually connect to it from your Elixir VM, and then call send receiver message, and it will receive your message on the other side. That's crazy, right? So the message, what can it be? Anything. Like literally anything. So I always encourage people to be curious and daring with this, right? Don't just think, oh, I have to like send ints and then I map them on the other side to something, you know, that's That's a different way of thinking. You can send the actual literal values, the strings, the binaries, whatever. Be curious and daring, but also be careful of that power, because you are making, conceptually anyways, deep copies of this data, and you're going to be filling the other guy's inbox. And if you do send, you know, 18 gigabytes of data via send, it will happily try and do this for you. Yes. But generally, most sane things that you want to do, if you have some term, whether it's a tuple or a map or a struct, whatever, you can generally just pass it across using send receiver message. So let's take a look at this. So I create here an anonymous function. It just says, you ran my code. I now, laser pointer, this is awkward. Good. So I then, it then the code then says, send to myself, so self is just a function that returns your own bit, so your own address, the function, f. And this is just an atom. I'm just sending a tuple. So I can pattern match on this message and go, oh, he's sending me a function. And this is just a protocol that I've invented for this toy example. You don't have to, you could have anything there. You can just pass f if you wanted, whatever. And then I go into a receive loop. Receive is how we actually get our messages. And we'll be seeing more receive, a lot more receive, in a bit. And in my receive, I then pattern match on what I'm getting. So I'm looking for a tuple that has func, and then some variable, which I am now expecting, because that's my agreement with myself here, right? It's my contract. I'm going to get a function here. I can then call that function. And what do you think is the result of this program? Any guess?
It's string.
Yeah, it's going to actually output, you just ran my code. Now, we didn't have to send it to ourselves. We could have sent that to another node somewhere else in our network, and it would run that function.
But it does not return that string.
No, well, it does here, locally. So I'm running it locally. I'm running it here. Not where I sent it, but where I receive it and execute it. Right? This is you don't usually send functions around this way, but it's interesting that you can. It just shows you can literally like send almost anything you want. So we saw receive. How does that work? Very simply, receive do, you put your pattern. If it matches the pattern, it's going to run whatever's after the error. And then you end your block. That's it. That's all it takes to receive. Nothing more, nothing less. Now you can, of course, have multiple patterns. And depending on what they're matching, they could be matching completely different things. Maybe one matches a function. Maybe one matches a binary. Maybe one matches a specific map. And as with pattern matching, anywhere else in Elixir, where you're probably familiar with it from function heads. Hello. Can I have my screen back? You? Yeah. Let's see.
Oh, what the hell?
Elixir is too much for it. Did it overheat or?
No clue. We'll see. Never done that, so I don't know.
Oh, there we go. Slowly but surely. Oh, lovely. Thank you. Yeah. Now all we need is a cat. It looks really dark.
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay. Good. Where's my pointer? There it is, up there, somewhere. There it is. Okay. We are receive, yeah? Oh, almost. There we go. Good. So you can have multiple patterns. They can match completely different things, and you run some code. And of course, like any other pattern matching, you can bind variables here. So it's very, very powerful. And of course, you can also have a default, right? Just underscore. And this tosses it away, as it always does in Elixir. This is just like the match it, but throw it away. Now, why would you, has anybody any guess why you might put a default branch in your receive?
Error handling? Just to match anything, like, that's a follow through, basically.
Yeah, exactly. So say someone sends you something you don't expect it, yeah?
Otherwise it would stay in the box, right?
Right, it'll just stay in the inbox, because until we pull it out of our inbox, it hangs out there. And so it's actually, you're both right. You do this to make sure that if somebody sends you garbage, you pattern match on it. But it also prevents your inbox from filling. Now, you don't always want to do this. There's a lot of times you're like, no, this is what I pattern match on, the rest of you can screw off. But this is often very useful, particularly when we start doing things like this. Let's see how that works. Oh, yeah. Now I can wander everywhere. Great. So, in this case, we have one more clause. This is the after, and then a timeout. So if we start a process and we go, okay, I'm waiting for a message. It's gonna come, right? But you're not gonna wait forever, perhaps. You can put in after and then a timeout in milliseconds, so 1,000, 1 second, 5,000, 5 seconds, whatever. And then after that timeout clicks, you can run some arbitrary code, which might clean up, it might fall into an error handler, whatever. All right, now we're going to wrap all of that in a function called loop in this case, for reasons that will become apparent. So now what we're doing is we have a receive loop, we have a receive block. We match, we have two patterns that we're matching here. And this obviously is not how you actually have a pattern, not just pattern A, pattern B. And then when we match pattern A, we do some function A, and then we call loop again. I'm just going to bring this back here. If pattern B matches, we do B, then it loops. If we get an unexpected message, so the error case, we just fall out. That'll end this function, right? And of course, after a timeout, where our timeout will be, same thing, we just error up. In other words, this is your essential server loop, right? That's just gonna go wait for a certain period of time, and of course you leave the after, just sits there forever, until it receives one or these two messages it knows it accepts. And if you send anything else, it just goes away, okay? This is all it takes to write essentially a server in Elixir. That's it. And that's really the power of the idea of send and receive. It makes things that would take dozens of lines of code in most other languages take a handful. And really, this is as complex as receive loops tend to get. Now, we take it one step further, and we say, well, we actually want to have some sort of state. So we want to, maybe this is a process that's going to process for a specific user. So everything that comes in, all the messages, we're going to apply to a certain user's data in our database, or whatever, or on the socket. Or maybe the state has a socket in it. Every time we get a message, we're going to send something across that socket to whoever's on the other side. So we have a parameter here called state. So when we call into this function, we're going to call loop state, whatever that might be, a user or a socket, whatever it is we're doing. We're then going to pattern match on it. We're going to send that state into that doA function, which we then, by contract, say it's going to return, and then we pass it back into loop. Now we have a stateful loop. So now when we get pattern A, doA can do something. It can modify the state of the function or our server, and we pass it back out. So this is a stateful server now, just with that tiny modification. Are there any questions about this? Now, you're not going to write a whole lot of code like this yourself, thankfully. But this is what's happening behind the scenes for a lot of the common patterns, things like gen server. That's all this is. This is like, peel back the curtain, what's behind it. This is the machinery. Nothing more complex than this. So yeah, message passing is amazing. It is so powerful, so easy to use. It's network transparent. You can send messages across from point A to point B, pattern match, write stateful servers in half a dozen lines of code. It's really one of the treasures, I think, of Elixir. All right, so we'll switch gears, and we'll talk about separation of concerns. So this whole idea of processes having their own memory space, right? So they have their own data set. So let's say that we actually started a process with that loop function, right? That guy. So that, say that was our process right there. In object-oriented programming, we have objects, right? And they're data with associated code that can either retrieve or modify that data, right? In Elixir, we have processes. This is where we encapsulate our data. And then in the processes, they have an API by message passing. And internally, they use your code that you put into nice little modules to actually interact with that data. So you can kind of think of that as an analog. Joe, the guy who I had the slide earlier about, we have 2 million web servers that each handle one process. He often talks about this as well, how Elixir is a very object-oriented language in the sense that you have these processes that are your objects because they contain your data and the code. Now, thanks to the shared nothing design, processes are fully isolated from each other. This is beautiful. So we think about this task earlier, right? These four young gentlemen were trying to figure out how to orchestrate their hands to make sure they didn't run into each other. These guys just did the graph. This is a much easier problem when you're isolated from each other. So in Elixir, processes keep your concerns separated. You don't really have a choice. You start a process, it's on its own. The only way it can interact with the outside world is through message passing. So this makes it like perfectly suited to representing instance-specific data or actions. And so we're going to be taking a look at various demos and things. We'll actually see this in action where you can divide up your application in ways that the processes map to your domains or map to the actual functions of the application. So in Phoenix, what is it doing? It's serving web requests. And it has web sockets. So when a request comes in, you have one process that's listening to the socket. It immediately, as soon as it gets a connect, a TCP connect, it immediately throws that into a child process. Actually, Cowboy does that. That then takes that process, accepts the connection, starts the HTTP communication, and then runs whatever your code is for that connection. And that might end up calling into Ecto to talk to your database, which is another set of processes. And they're communicating back and forth by message passing. Even though you don't really see it, because it's all nicely hidden from us, thanks to the very nice libraries that come with Elixir, that's what's happening in the background. So all of our concerns are like clearly separated. Database stuff is over here in these processes. This one HTTP request is in this one process, and when that request is done, that process goes away. This is actually important to understand because just the other week someone asked about how to preserve state in channels. And so in Phoenix, you have WebSockets. It has a pub-sub system where you can have channels that are just basically a topic, and you can send messages. And the guy asked, and it's a very good question, how do I keep state there? Because I want to, you know, I have like this channel, and it's actually related to a certain topic, and it has some data associated. How do I keep the state there? And he wanted to access the state like from the HTTP process, because that's where he was creating it. It's like, well, no. When that request is fulfilled, the process goes away. The WebSocket is a long-lived process that continues, but it's separate. So if you want that that state, you have to pass it from your web request into the WebSocket process. And that's why whenever you see example code around WebSockets and channels in Phoenix, they'll be calling like socket.assigns.whatever. The socket it's not an object, it's a process. And that socket process is where your data lives. Yeah. And again, there's a little bit pedantic. There are exceptions to this shared nothing, but they're completely hidden from you. You can't see them, you can't violate it. But just so you know, from a performance perspective, there's actually a lot of shared stuff. But don't worry about it. Just don't worry that, oh my god, there's nothing to share, it's going to be horribly slow. It's slower than C and Rust, but it's not that slow. So, lifespan tracking. This is the third major like leg of the stool. Processes can be big brother to each other. They can watch them, they can monitor them, they can link to them. And this is how you achieve resiliency and robustness in an Elixir program. So when you link one process to another, it just connects them. So if I say link to this process, it's going to link that process to me. When that process dies, I'm going to die. So when it exits, if it exits abnormally, I'm going to exit. Okay, that's kind of neat. You can also monitor. So instead of actually just saying, just kill me, if he dies, like if he crashes, if he's like enters an error state and just goes away, right? So not a normal exit, but something abnormal. That's linking. But monitoring just says, let me know when it happens. So there's a flag you can set in your process called trap exit, and this will let you know when the processes that you're monitoring have like died a horrible death. And then you can do something about it. Well, what might you do about it? There we go. Don't want that to go well. So, supervisors. Who's come across supervisors in Elixir? Or supervisor trees? Yeah. That's what a supervisor is. A supervisor is a process, and its whole point of living is to make the system robust and predictable. What it does is it monitors other processes. And when they die horribly, it does something. Maybe it restarts them. Maybe it tries to restart them 5 times before giving up. And if it gives up, it kills itself. And then whatever supervising it can then take over. We'll look at some of the strategies that you can use with it. But what it means is that a failure is something that can be embraced. Most times when you write code, we write defensive code. It's like, oh, errors are bad. We have to handle them and like deal with them. In Elixir, we only deal with the errors that are meaningful. If there's a way to deal with an error, if there's a way to actually get out and back to good execution from an error. So let's say I'm trying to reach a web service and it comes back with, 503 or something. Maybe I can handle that. Or maybe it comes back with a rate limiting message. I go, okay, I'm gonna back off. I'm gonna sleep for a bit, I'll come back. That's something you can recover from. That's something you can enter a known good state from. However, let's say you're trying to reach your database for authentication and you can't reach the database. That may be something the application cannot recover from because that request requires authentication, and if your source of authentication is not there, what can you do? So you just crash, you die. This has a number of nice side effects. It gives you nice stack traces, it gives you nice horrible messages that are completely unreadable, but useful. But more importantly, it gives the supervisor that's watching that guy the opportunity to do something about it. Log it, restart it, try it again. Wait a bit, try again, give up after a certain point, terminate the entire application maybe, right? So kind of the core of supervisor is start link. So we talked about linking. When you start starting a process is referred to as spawning, and there's actually, we'll see that later in the demos, there's a function called spawn, allows you to start a process with a function. But supervisors, you tend to do start link. You give them some children, these are the processes they're going to watch, right? They're going to monitor these child processes and decide what to do if things go wrong. And they have a strategy. So the children, it's a list of function specifications that the supervisor will start and then monitor. Okay, what's a function specification? Simple, it's a function with some default arguments. That's all, right? So it says, oh, so this module, that function with these arguments, start him. Now, so it often looks like this. You give it an ID, this is just an atom, could be whatever, my database, my whatever. The module that it lives in, an atom, that's the function in the module and the term. This is often referred to as MFA form, module function argument. So we see MFA, that's what they're meaning, just a tuple with those three things. So if you have a module, well, we'll see them later in the demos. And then you can provide some things that it can and should do. Yeah, you rarely ever use this because there's nicer ways of doing it. We'll see these. Generally use the options for that. And the options are used to define a name for your supervisor. So if you want to reach your supervisor by name, so we talked about send receiver, and the receiver could be a PID or a name. So you can give your supervisor a name, and we'll see why that's useful. You can tell it should it start or restart function or processes if they die abnormally. If so, how many times? Should it try 5 times, 10 times, 20 times, infinite number of times? Oftentimes there's a limit. You just go, look, if it doesn't work 5 times in a row, just give up, kill yourself. There's no road back. And also time limits. So you can say, okay, look, everything you start should actually like return to you and say, I'm alive within 1 second or 10 seconds or whatever. And this allows you some method of discovering when your children have wedged and are just stuck, right? So this allows you to write a system where it's impossible, or well, theoretically impossible, to create a set of children that will put the application into a known or an unknown state. Worst case scenario, your entire application crashes and refuses to run, right? But you're never in an unknown state. And in the typical case, it just restarts things until things start working again. You can also give it a management strategy. And there's a set of strategies. So there's one for one. So you can have any number of children, right? Maybe you've got a database pool. Maybe you've got another thing that looks after your web connection sockets, whatever. In a one for one strategy, if one process fails, it restarts that one process. Right, that seems common sense, right? So, okay. One for all is that if any one of its children die, it just kills everybody, goes, you know, nuclear on them, kills all of its children, and restarts everything. This is very useful when you have a set of processes that actually need to work together. And if one of them goes bad, then you can't guarantee a known good state, so just start over. There's rest for one. Ooh, there's rest for one. I've honestly never used that myself, but I've seen it used. What this does is very esoteric. So let's say you've got 10 children. Child number 7 in your list dies. It will then kill 8, 9, and 10 and restart 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah. I've never had to use 4. This one, however, is very common. Simple one for one. Instead of giving it a list of children, you give it just one child specification. It's like your template. And then you just call it. You ask it, hey, spawn me another one of these. Give me another one of these. This is great for creating pools. It's great for creating things like, I have a handler for incoming connections on this port. Every time I get a new connection, give me one of the connection handlers, right? And it will spawn one on request, give you the process back, and supervise it. It's also faster. You can use one for one. Well, not really. Simple one for one is like one for one, but only with one child, and it avoids a ton of bookkeeping, so it's actually more performant. So you can see it does a few things, right? And while you could call monitor and link and try and manage the lifespan of your own processes, don't even bother. Just use supervisors, because there's a ton of work that's gone into them, and there's nothing really to add to them, so if you try and link and monitor your own processes, you're just going to make bugs. But again, I think it's really good to know what's happening. Like, what is a supervisor tree? How do they work? Why do they work that way? Great. So now we're back to this map. Now maybe this starts to make a little more sense to you, right? So we have the dark ones are, the dark blue ones are supervisors. And this one's called kernel_soup. That's a just kind of an idiom, at least in Erlang, to call them _soup. Elixir, you also call them supervisor, dot supervisor. But this guy is supervising all these guys. Now notice that he's also supervising a supervisor. Supervisors are just processes. So you can have supervisors that do supervisors, right? Big worlds have little worlds all the way down to viscosity. And so this is what's called a supervision tree, right? There's not just one supervisor with a bunch of children. You have a supervisor that supervises supervisors that then eventually have leaf nodes. So here we have processes that are meant to stay around if they die. So the global name server, you can kill that if you want. If this kernel supervisor will restart it. I'll say, what did you do that for? I need to restart that. That's a necessary part of my system. And if you somehow prevent it from doing so, it will die, and it has nowhere to really bubble. Your application will go away. All right? So at least you're not in a bad state. You're in a known state, the no-run state. Maybe not the one you wanted, but it's the one that you get. So here's another one, the kernel safe supervisor. And then there's some Elixir stuff. So there's the registry server. We'll actually see the registry later. There's hex fetcher, Elixir hex. So I just started IEX, right, with my mix project, and I got all these processes. And that's all they are. You have supervisors that supervise other supervisors or processes, Then you have some temporary processes that are not supervised. They're just sitting there. They've been spawned. Right? That's the light blue ones. And so when you run IEX, you get this huge set of processes. But it's not that scary. Just supervisors and children. Now, what's this? This was me sending a message from this PID that I spawned. I just created a function, put into a process, and it sent a message to those guys. And that red line is that message. If you think of your programs as a graph like this, at least for me, I don't know about you, for me it makes it a lot easier to understand what's happening and why I'm doing things the way I'm doing them. And when I'm in my Elixir or my Phoenix channel and wondering why can't I get its state in my channel function, I go, oh, that's right, because it's not the same. It's not actually a process. The socket is the process. The channel is just a function I'm running, so the state has to be in the socket, right? So, challenges and caveats. And this is where we then start to look at demos, because I'm going to pose some problems here, and we're going to look at how to solve them, as well as look at not problems and just, yeah. So, with the processes, the way the VM works, and how am I doing for time? Oh, I restarted. Damn, I don't know how long. Oh, 1901, okay. Because you've got all these processes, right, and by default, the VM will spawn one scheduling thread or one thread of execution per core, and then it'll try and spread your processes out among the cores. So you do get parallelism for free, you just don't see it. You just see this concurrency, very simple, easy to manage. But if you think about it, when you're scheduling processes, you're going to start and stop them. And as any of you know who have written like high-performance code, the last thing you want to do for throughput is start and stop. You just want to like read and write and read and write and don't stop, right? Node optimizes for throughput, and it has shitty latency. It has unpredictable latency. Latency goes boom, 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 up and down depending on what you're doing. That's why you can also stall a Node server by doing some computation, right? It's not scheduling anything. But it's a single thread of execution that just goes, so it's trying to give you as much throughput and then puts it in your hands to like manage that. Elixir takes the opposite approach, and it says it's more important for you to have concurrency and reliable latency. So you know when you're going to get a response, number one. And number two, you can have tons of things happening at the same time. And don't worry, we'll take care of it for you. So if you have something that's going to take 5 minutes to process, you're going to create a PDF, you're going to do a bunch of calculations, you're going to clean up some database row in some very inefficient manner, or table in some very inefficient manner, no problem. That's okay, I'm going to break it up for you. I'm going to let you run a certain amount of code in that process, and I'm going to swap in the next process, and back and forth. So that's the trade-off, though, but you should know that. Throughput is not its strong suit. If you need like absolute maximum throughput, data throughput, there are other tools. It does give you, conceptually, a non-deterministic order of process execution. You are not allowed to know in what order your processes are going to execute. Now, that's not always true in practice, but it's best to think of it that way because you will run into situations where it runs in a different order than you expect. And that will depend on the winds blowing and how many cores you have, right? So, reliability in message passing. Okay, we live in an imperfect world, as you may have noticed. And it's typical that if you have like you have your beautiful airline cluster Elixir cluster, and it's running like five machines, you're like, I have the most amazing thing in the world, and then you have a net split, right? And two of your machines can't see the other three, and you're screwed. So the reliability of supervisors and the beauty of message passing gets you a lot, but I want to tell you, they're not silver bullets. You still have to think about things like distribution and whatnot, and keep that in mind. Generally, if you're running a single application on a single machine, ignore that. You'll have all the reliability and message passing beauties you want. Of course, if you have the situation where you just like keep feeding messages into a process that never picks it up, you can also... Well, actually, it's not true anymore. As of 19, there's a limit on message blocks now. So you can't actually kill it that way either. Bottlenecks are a huge problem. So people will, especially when they first start out writing code in Elixir, they'll be like, okay, so I have some shared state, right? There's some state in my application that I want to be able to access from multiple processes. I know, I'll stuff that state into a process, right? Because Aaron said they're like objects, so I'm going to put them in the object. Great, I have a process. And then all my other processes are going to talk to that process to get the state. And then, of course, you have a bottleneck. So you have one process that's going through one message box and serially processing those messages. Of course the processor being swapped in and out of the execution. So we have to think about bottlenecks when it comes to shared resources and shared state. Typically, again, you don't run into these things too much, but they do exist. Okay, so I'm done my presentation. We get to see live demos, or as I like to think of it, seeing it in action or just tempting fate. All right, so processes. There we go. Okay. Oh, not chaos.
Maybe zoom in a bit.
Ah, oh, yes, right. Okay. There are limits to things. Good. Right. So I've got some demos put together. I've got my slides and these demos up online in case you want, for some bizarre reason, to look at them later. You can. So, processes. Here's the code of our little guy right here. So, what we're going to do here is we're going to create a process, right? It's a very simple function. It just outputs to terminal, all done. And then we're going to take a look at the process ID. You have to say inspect here because a PID can't be translated on its own to a character. It doesn't allow that. So we have this little inspect helper that can put almost anything into a printable statement. And then we're going to say, is it still alive? All right? All right, let's try that. Don't worry, the demos get more interesting than this. They build up. Holy crap, that's big. Yes. Good, there we are. So our process had a PID of 0189.0. The front zero, by the way, tells you that's running on your own node. So if it was running on a remote node, we'll see that. Is it still alive? No, it's done because, of course, let me make that bigger. All it did is put something out to terminal, and then the function was done. The process then goes away. So we created another process, and then it just went away. That's how simple it is. Okay. If you want something just to stay there forever, you can do things like process.sleepinfinity, and it'll just sit there idling in the background, taking exactly zero CPU, some memory, not a lot by default. If you don't do anything, it takes 300 words by default of system memory. Neat trivia. But then it just sits there. It doesn't do anything. You can kill it. You can send it messages, fill up its inbox. That'll crash it eventually. But this will just sit there. All right. So now we're going to do some addressing. We're going to spawn a process. All right. So we've got an echo, which is actually in another module called messages, right? So this is showing how modules are how we organize code, but our processes are how we put them together at runtime. So we're going to create a process that runs messages echo, which we'll look at next. Then we're going to send in a message, and it's actually going to send it back to us. It's going to echo out to terminal. Then we're going to give it a name. We're going to call it echo, and then we can just send echo. And then we're going to put it into a registry. And a registry is really cool. Registries allow you to have more than one or more named spaces, like namespaces. You can put processes in, so you don't have just like one global. And you can distribute this across a cluster, which is ridiculously cool. If any of you have done like distributed processing by hand, this is like, makes me happy. So let's prove that this works. Not so exciting, I know. But there we go. Now that's interesting. It's outputting stuff after it says, we said we found our process in the registry. This is because it's happening asynchronously, right? So I have obviously more than one core in my laptop. It's executing on different threads and different CPUs. It's not going to happen in the same order every time. It's not going to happen in the order that we see it here. It's going to send the PID. It's going to send this message to our echo process, and the echo process is going to take its own time to do whatever the hell it does. It could sleep for 5 hours and then come back and do something. We don't know. We don't care. So that's interesting. So we now have a little counter function here, and now we're going to actually do some concurrency, right? So we're going to create a bunch of counters, And we're going to start, so we can say how many threads of execution we want to start, how many concurrent processes. Then we're going to give it a number to count up to, and they're all going to count up to that same number on their own. Right? It's like you guys doing the graph on your own. Alright. So how many threads should we do? How many processes?
Ten.
How many?
Ten.
Okay. And what should they count to?
10.
All right. I like the man. He has imagination. He knows where he's going in life. Oh, sorry. Boom. That's interesting, right? So you can see we have our different process IDs. So the counters are doing, if you look. Hello. Oh, I moved it. It's outputting again to terminal its own PID. So what process is this in? And then the number it's counted to. And it's just recursive, right? It counts it. Just, yeah. Great. So here we see we have our 10 PIDs, our 10 processes that are counting to 10. Now let's be a bit more ambitious. Let's count to, oh, fine, that's good too. Great, we're done. And you'll see that they don't all count. In fact, one of them, because we had 10 processes and I only have so many cores, one of them got hung up to the end and did a bunch of counting all by itself, right? So this really shows that when you're writing concurrent programs, don't plan on the order of execution. Just plan on them being executed. The VM will take care of the rest for you. But that's all there is really to processes. There's no more magic than that. Well, there is, but... So, next. I believe I actually have a slide for each set of demos. So I remember which order to do them in. Thinking ahead. Good. So, messages. So there's our echo, right? And there's his receive. He receives any... Well, let me make it a bit bigger. Is that better? Good. Sorry, I can see you squinting like, what is he doing? You just trust me. I'll tell you. So he has a receive block. He's receiving just a random message. And this is pattern matching. So it binds that message into message. And then we spit it out. And then we call ourselves again. That's that server loop, right? So this guy will just go on forever until we tell it to, like, screw off and die. Oh, yes. Waiting for Godot. Let's see if I can do this one. I'll start waiting. I don't know if you know the reference. It's a famous play that's it's very surrealistic, and it's about people waiting for someone that never shows up. Oh, sorry. Hold on. This is what I get for. This is why unit testing is important, kids. I don't have networks, so. Technically, I could have just recompiled that in place and it would replace it, but that would require more typing. And I'm lazy. Yay! So now we have our PID, and of course I didn't assign it to anything. Let's do that. So we can actually say, okay, my PID is, and there's this little Erlang function, this to PID, so whenever you forget to bind, because I always do that, and then you just say 0.153.0. Great, now I have my PID, bound to PID. Hooray! So now I can send messages to my Godot function here, right? So he's waiting until he receives a hello message. There. So he's waiting for a hello message. He's just going to stay there and wait. Once he gets one, he's going to move on to another receive block that's waiting for Godot. Or after 10 milliseconds, he's just going to give up. All right, so, let's send to PID something random. All right, we don't see anything. Let's let Godot show up, even though that never happens in the real play. Oh shit. Good. And now let's say hello to it. And now what should happen is it should go out of this receive block because it pattern matches on hello. It'll say where is Godot. Then it will try and receive a message called Godot out of its inbox, which we did send it, so it's there. And he'll say, yay, I found him. At least, well, let's find out. Aha, it worked, right? And now the process exits as well. So this is how message passing in theory or in its essence works. Again, you're not going to write code like this very often, but this is what the code you do write is doing it behind the scenes. Great. So
how about the other messages you send? They are seemingly simple?
Until the process exits. So in that case, right, once it received hello, it falls out of this receive block. Then it goes into this receive block, and it either receives Godot, or after 10 milliseconds, just randomly, because no particular reason, these are all toys, they're not serious code, it just says, oh, Godot never showed up, and then it exits this receive block, hits the end of the function, and the process goes away. With it, all of its memory. So it's working set, and it's inbox. So those messages, yeah, indeed, will be in its inbox, unused, but the memory will be released, and the system will be fine again. Okay, so what's next? Gen server. Okay, so this is actually the kind of code you're going to write. I'm not going to run this. We'll just read through it really quick. Well, maybe I will. We'll see. Why not? Okay, so we have some functions here, some public functions, def, start, link. So in gen server, it's what's called a behavior. It defines essentially a way things work. Think of it like a class. A superclass you can subclass from. They're basically saying that this module is basically going to be gen server-y. So we're going to get access to a bunch of its plumbing. So we define a start link, and then we call gen server start link our own module. So proc demos gen server, just a built-in macro, and then we create our state. Remember we had that loop that had a state variable. That's equivalent to this. We just say start us. Our state is an empty map. And then we provide some function calls. These are just our public API, right? So we pass in the process ID of our gen server, a key, and it calls lookup on it. Now call is a synchronous call. So our function's gonna block when it calls that other process. Basically what it does is it sends a message, then it goes into a receive loop. Just think of it that way. Then we say we can store. So this is like a KV store, key value store, right? So we can say, okay, store that value to that key. It's going to asynchronously cast it. So it's going to return immediately. We're not going to wait for a reply. We could manually go into receive loop if we were thinking we're going to get a reply. But this leaves it up to us. And then it passes a message into our PID, store key value. And we also have a stop, just because you don't normally have that. Just thought I'd do it to show you that you can get rid of PIDs. So down here, we have the API for gen servers. Handle calls, handle cast. There's others, but these are the most common, most useful. And again, we're pattern matching. So you see that these messages match up. So when we pass in a message by a gen server to our PID that we've started, lookup key, it's actually going to end up in this function that's running in our process. And it's going to then take the state, and it's going to look up the key in the map that is our state. And it's going to return the state. When we store something, right, we pass in the key, the value, and the state, which is a map. That's what we defined at the very beginning, way up here. Right? We said our state starts off as just a map. We put that into our map, and we return that, and that becomes our new state. Again, it's just that loop with a state. That's all it is. All right, let's quickly see this in action, hopefully. Oh, that's captured. I did that time, so I have to do that again. Great. Oh, right. So, gen server always returns OK PID. So, let's call it real PID, just so I could type more as punishment. Good. So now I have my PID, right? So now I can use my public API. So now we're not. Doesn't even look like we're going to be passing messages. It's like we're just object-oriented programming. We call functions. Well. It's Python-style object-oriented programming, perhaps, where you just think of as the PID as the this or the object, right? So we're going to call, let's store a value. What should we store? Give me a key.
Hello, world.
Oh, hello, world. Good. Oh,
Real pit instead of pit.
Oh, right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Okay, good. So the storing came from the process that's running, as you can see down here in handle cast. Yeah? All right, let's look up our key. And these are horrible function names. I just picked them to show that, you know, I'm not pulling an actual pattern. There's no map. I'm just making something horrible up. But we go hello, and we get world back. This is message passing with multiple processes. And this is typically how you write most of your processes in Elixir. You use something like GenServer. Often you just use GenServer. And you create a public API that everyone uses, things like start link, value, store, stop. And then it internally calls and casts and actually does the message passing. The reason for that is the same reason that we do private and public and everything else in object-oriented programming, right? We're trying to encapsulate and hide. So we encapsulate our data inside the gen server and we hide implementation details. So you don't have to know, oh, I have to send a message called lookup key. I just call value key. And however that happens internally is an internal detail to the gen server. But at the end of the day, it's message passing, yes?
But nothing can keep you from sending any message to any process, right?
That's correct. And so in that case, you can do something like, so come down here, and oftentimes if you want to have a situation where you're like, nah, I need to be ready for anything, right? Actually, it's not going to leave me happy. I'm going to bail, right? I'm going to say there's some error. So now if I send this say an unknown message, it will bail. But you can also pass it on to back to Gen server. And then your message you received or whatever. This is only useful when you're using a behavior that actually has some useful, like, parents class or parent function implementations. Cool. Okay.
Does it make sense?
Yep.
Does it make sense to send a reply in the handle class instead of a no reply?
It depends. So, let's say you got a function or a process, and what it's going to do is it's going to take in a request from, a user. And that's going to go off, it's going to fetch some data, produce, let's say, a GIF file, an image, right? And then when it's done processing, it's then going to send it back to the user, ready send it with the name they asked for. Now that one process may be handling multiple requests from the user, right? So it basically says, okay, you want graph A image, great, I'm going to go hand that off to a process. You do that asynchronously, right? Then, okay, another one comes in, you hand that off. And then you get a message back, right? And if you're using Gen server, you don't have to worry about where do I put my receive loop. You just do handle cast, handle call. So then the worker process will then send the result back to the caller. And so in that case, yeah, it really does make sense. But this is all about design, right? Do you
fetch the message in there you receive?
Typically not. Typically you have two Gen servers, right? And you'll have messages they're passing back and forth, and you'll catch them in your handle call, handle cast. So yes, you can do it in receive. But it's tricky, right? And that's the whole point of like Gen server and all these other tools is it just takes away all the complexity for you. You just go, here's all the messages I'm expecting to receive, here's the ones I'm expecting to send, you just implement that. Cool. Where are we here? Supervisor. Okay, quickly. Right, so here's a supervisor. We don't run it. It doesn't matter. In this case, this is a simple one-for-one. Once I start this guy, actually, I think it has already started. Yeah, it is. Yeah, that's right. I wrote these for this talk specifically, so I have to remember what I wrote yesterday. Good. So when you start this supervisor, it creates a simple one-for-one. Remember, that was the guy that can just take one child as a template, and every time you ask it for a new one, it just spawns a new guy for you? That's why it's called Spawner. It's a great name. We have a function again called new server that provides basically a public API. And all it does is call start child, and we've named it, or you'll see what we name it in a second. And it calls itself give me a child. Now, here's the magic happens. Inside of my proc demos module, it's an application, imports supervisor spec. I create some children. One is a registry, we'll see in a moment. Oh, we used that earlier actually. When we registered a process with the proc demos registry, that was that registry right there. We also create the proc demos supervisor. So in theory, right, I should be able to, and this is a one for one, so if my spawner dies, it's just gonna restart it for me. If my registry dies, it's gonna restart it for me. We'll look at how cool that is in a moment. Yep. So, in theory, I should have, if all works out, spawner, boom, I have a new server. And I got another one, and another one, and another one, and another one, and another one, because that's all it does. But that shows you how easy it is to set up a supervision tree. That's what that is. You have a supervisor supervising a supervisor that's spawning processes that it's supervising. Okay. And these are very trivial toy kind of things, but I think it's useful because it shows how these complex or detailed topics are actually really simple in practice. Okay. So, unreliable task. This is kind of interesting. So, all right, let's proc demos dot unreliable task. Spawn a task. Yep. We need to give it an input value. So I give it a 2, it dies. If I give it a 1, it dies. What does it want now? Work. Oh, yes, so it does expect a 1. There we go. Right, so I get my nil, and then it dies on me horribly. So we have a task that's dying on us, right? So we want to do something about it. We want to, right here what we're doing is we're creating a task, which is basically a little wrapper around a fire and forget task. We're running it asynchronously, we wait for it, it dies on us. Okay, well, what can we do? All right, well, we could supervise it. And in fact, task comes with a task supervisor. Awesome, we don't have to start one or make one. So let's try that. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna keep calling, we hope that we can call it again when it dies and keep going. And it's not actually doing what we want. So if we look at the code, we're waiting for the task, and the task crashes, we don't actually get a useful response. It never gets to the point where it's saying, you know, oh no, or whatever. So it's randomly dying, which is kind of neat. So why is that happening? So when we start a child, even if it's supervised, it gets restarted, that's good. It's actually gonna eventually succeed, which is why we eventually see that nil at the end. But we're never going to get here. We're never going to get a useful result. We're never going to get, we got a return, and it is RV. And the reason is because the task that we got back is dead. The PID is, it crashed, and a new one is made, has its own PID, it's its own process. So this is actually from a question that I saw on Elixir Forum, where it said, I got a task, it's supervised, why can't I get the value? Shouldn't it just keep trying until it returns the proper value? And the issue is, of course, well, it's not the same task. It's a different process. So if you wait on that process, it's gone already. It's dead. So what we need to do is something a little more complex, and we're going to do a receive here. And what we're going to do is we're going to start the worker, this guy down here, who randomly exits, and we're going to wait until we get a message that says, I got success. We don't know what process it's going to come from. It could die 4 times, 3 times, we don't know, it's random, it's actually random. But eventually, hopefully, one of them will succeed, and when they succeed, they're going to tell us. How do they know to send it to us? Well, we actually are sending our PID to the worker. So it knows who to message back. So that question about, does it ever make sense to send messages back? Here's an example where it is. If you have a task that you expect could fail, and is going to crash and be restarted, now, the neat thing about this is that if I'm going to pass it a, what do I call it again? Swan of Restoring Tau. Nope. Yes. That's a spot. Which... did I change my...
Hold on.
Let me actually start the supervisor here. All right. You can only do that in your supervision tree. Cool. So we gave it an input of 3. Actually, there we go. That one actually crashed that time. There's another crash. Hooray. So it's crashing, but we're getting back eventually. I'm taking down the supervisor every time to clean up after myself. So it's crashing in the background perhaps, but eventually it succeeds and it gets to work with an input of 3, and then we actually get our message back from this PID. There we go. So this is a way of handling responses from unreliable processes. Just remember that if you're waiting on a process and it's going to die, So you can again do this with, if you're doing gen server or whatnot, you would just, instead of having a receive loop, you'd have a handle call or handle cast or whatever, and then you'd catch the message there. Or handle info. Handle info is when you don't call or cast, you send a random message to your mailbox, and then you implement it that way. So again, most of this code is not what you would do in production, please, but it shows you kind of what's happening and how to make things go with the concepts we saw. Cluster. All right, this is the last one. So I'm actually running two other, which you can't see because they're tiny, but two other nodes here, B and C, because I'm creative with my names. So let's actually see this guy in action. In theory, if I come here, reload. In the meantime,
you're still in the REPL.
Oh, I'm in the REPL. Thank you. So, my cluster. What we're going to do is we're going to spawn some workers on remote nodes. Okay, so I'm going to create a list of nodes here. So, nodes equals, and this is horrible syntax. Oh my god, it's ugly. But, this is basically a remote address, right? So it's got, we're A. I want B and C. But node addresses are atoms, but atoms can't have these special characters, so you have to, like, do that. Great. So I have my nodes, just in a list. They're just atoms. They don't actually point anywhere. They're just, this is the address you can go and see these nodes at. And then what we're going to do is we're going to create so we're going to do init remote on that one node. That's going to spawn our process on the other VM. So it's going to remotely spawn a process. We're going to remember where it is, and it's going to spawn this worker function, right? That does receive, and you can send count messages, increment messages, then exit. And then we're going to do this however many times we want, from 1, 2, 3. We're going to see how many counts are in the PIDs. So they're counters, right? And then we're going to clean up after that. All right, so let's... So basically, we're going to get them to count to like 100,000, I think it is. Something like that. Cool. All right. So, proc demos. Boom, dance. Right. Nodes and times, yeah, 1 is fine. Okay. Oh, that's not good. That's gonna work. Oh, right. Hold on. Uh, should be fine though. So it's saying here that it doesn't have the function I've asked for. That's weird. No.
Mm-hmm. Gonna take the two arguments.
Oh. Oh, my notes. God damn it. Yes, thanks. Yeah. I'm still saying it doesn't have cluster work. That's not good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Right, I namespaced everything to make it look slightly better. That was silly. There it is. Oh. Uh-huh. All right. Yeah. Rebuild. There we go. I can do that again. Let's just copy and paste, shall we? Yeah. So that was sending 100,000 messages to each cluster, each node in my cluster. Oh, we didn't see it because... All right, so there's my nodes. Should find my cluster. There it is, the title again. Am I going to get graphics? Show me graphics. No! Oh, why can't it see me? Oh, I know why. Hold on, sorry. Yeah.